Welcome to Heavy D Storytelling. How are you doing today? We are going to be reading a story. But first we are going to be doing daily devotions with Daniel, and then we are going to be doing a synopsis with Kimberly, and then we are going to be... I didn't do it correctly. This is what happens when I get a day filled with fun. Okay, let me restart that. Hello, welcome to Heavy D Storytelling. Today we are going to be reading a story, but first up we are going to be doing daily devotions with Daniel, and then we are going to be doing Bible reading time. And then we are going to be doing the synopsis with Kimberly, and then we are going to be reading the Twin Towers. I've been waiting for the Twin Towers, not only because it's much easier to say than the Fellowship of the Ring, but also because I really like this book. Hi, Mommy. Yes, we did get some sun today, Mom.
All right. Okay, Daniel's done.
Here is Daniel for Daily Devotions with Daniel.
Hello, I'm tired. So today is June 4th. This is Universal Reflection. Since the creation of the world, his invisible attributes are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even his eternal power and Godhead, so that they are without excuse. Oh gosh, I'm out of breath. The heavens declare the glory of God. By looking into the stellar sky, we can learn many facts about God, since the universe appears almost limitless in extent. The first cause, God, must be virtually infinite. Must be virtually infinite. Since the universe appears almost endless in duration, he must be virtually eternal. Since the universe pulsates with energy, he must be omnipotent. Since the universe is phenomenally complex and contains intelligent life, God must be omniscient. Since the universe contains feeling and emotions and love and human relations, its creator must be personal, since the universe contains goodness and righteousness and love and justice. He must be moral. A cornerstone of the Christian faith is belief that God is the creator. During the last days, those who deny his rightful role as creator and lord of creation will separate themselves from him forever. Marvel at what he has made today. A man can no more diminish God's glory by refusing to worship him than a lunatic can put out the sun by scribbling darkness on the wall of his cell. C.S. Lewis.
Hello! One correction. It is not the Twin Towers. It is the Two Towers. But that's okay. All right, so we are in the book of 1 Samuel still. This is the English Standard Version, chapter 25, and let me begin. Now, Samuel died. This always took me by surprise, because here we are, not even through the first book of Samuel, and Samuel died. So why are both books called Samuel? More to follow. All right. I'll begin again. Now Samuel died, all Israel assembled and mourned for him, and they buried him in his house at Ramah. Then David rose and went down to the wilderness of Paran, and there was a man in Maon whose business was in Carmel. The man was very rich. He had 3,000 sheep and 1,000 goats. He was shearing his sheep in Carmel. Now the name of the man was Nabal, and the name of his wife Abigail. The woman was discerning and beautiful, but the man was harsh and badly behaved. He was a Calebite. David heard in the wilderness that Nabal was shearing his sheep. So David sent 10 young men, and David said to the young men, "Go up to Carmel and go to Nabal and greet him in my name. And thus you shall greet him. Peace be to you, and peace be to your house, and peace be to all that you have. I hear that you have shearers. Now your shepherds have been with us, and we did them no harm, and they missed nothing all the time they were in Carmel. Ask your young men, and they will tell you. Therefore, let my young men find favor in your eyes, for we come on a feast day. Please give whatever you have at hand to your servants and to your son David." When David's young men came, they said all this to Nabal in the name of David, and then they waited. And Nabal answered David's servants, "Who is David? Who is the son of Jesse? There are many servants these days who are breaking away from their masters. Shall I take my bread and my water and my meat that I have killed for my shearers and give it to men who come from I do not know where?" So David's young men turned away and came back and told him all this. And David said to his men, "Every man strap on his sword," and every man of them strapped on his sword. David also strapped on his sword, and about 400 men went up after David, while 200 remained with the baggage. But one of the young men told Abigail, Nabal's wife, "Behold, David sent messengers out of the wilderness to greet our master, and he railed against them. Yet the men were very good to us, and we suffered no harm, and we did not miss anything when we were in the fields, as long as we were with them. They were a wall to us both by night and by day, all the while we were with them keeping the sheep. Now therefore know this, and consider what you should do, for harm is determined against our master and against all his house, and he is such a worthless man that one cannot speak to him." Then Abigail made haste and took 200 loaves and 2 skins of wine and 5 sheep already prepared and 5 seahs of parched grain and 100 clusters of raisins and 200 cakes of figs, and laid them on donkeys. And she said to her young men, "Go on before me. Behold, I come after you. But she did not tell her husband Nabal. As she rode on the donkey and came down under cover of the mountain, behold, David and his men came down toward her, and she met them. Now David had said, "Surely in vain have I guarded all that this fellow has in the wilderness, so that nothing was missed of all that belonged to him, and he has returned me evil for good. God do so to the enemies of David, and more also, if by morning I leave so much as one male or of all who belong to him." When Abigail saw David, she hurried and got down from the donkey and fell before David on her face and bowed to the ground. She fell at his feet and said, "On me alone, my lord, be the guilt. Please let your servant speak in your ears and hear the words of your servant. Let not my lord regard this worthless fellow Nabal, for as his name is, so is he. Nabal is his name, and folly is with him. But I, your servant, did not see the young men of my lord whom you sent. Now then, my lord, as the Lord lives, as your soul lives, because the Lord has restrained you from blood guilt and from saving with your own hand, now then let your enemies and those who seek to do evil to my lord be as Nabal. And now let this present that your servant has brought to my lord be given to the young men who follow my lord. Please forgive the trespass of your servant, for the Lord will certainly make my lord a sure house, because my lord is fighting the battles of the Lord, and evil shall be found in you so long as you live. If men rise up to pursue you and to seek your life, The life of my Lord shall be bound in the bundle of the living in the care of the Lord your God, and the lives of your enemies he shall sling out as from the hollow of a sling. And when the Lord has done to my Lord according to all the good that he has spoken concerning you and has appointed you prince over Israel, my Lord shall have no cause of grief or pangs of conscience for having shed blood without cause or for my Lord working salvation himself. And when the Lord has dealt well with my Lord, then remember your servant. And David said to Abigail, blessed be the Lord, the God of Israel, who sent you this day to meet me. Blessed be your discretion, and blessed be you who have kept me this day from blood guilt and from working salvation with my own hand. For as surely as the Lord, the God of Israel, lives, who has restrained me from hurting you, unless you had hurried and come to meet me, truly by morning there had not been left to Nabal so much as one male. Then David received from her hand what she had brought him, and he said to her, go up in peace to your house. See, I have obeyed your voice, and I have granted your petition. And Abigail came to Nabal, and behold, he was holding a feast in his house, like the feast of a king. And Nabal's heart was merry within him, for he was very drunk. So she told him nothing at all until the morning light. In the morning, when the wine had gone out of Nabal, his wife told him these things, and his heart died within him, and he became as a stone. And about 10 days later, the Lord struck Nabal, and he died. When David heard that Nabal was dead, he said, blessed be the Lord, who has avenged the insult I have received at the hand of Nabal, and has kept back his servant from wrongdoing. The Lord has returned the evil of Nabal on his own head. Then David sent and spoke to Abigail to take her as his wife. When the servants of David came to Abigail at Carmel, they said to her, David has sent us to you to take you to him as his wife. And she rose and bowed with her face to the ground and said, behold, your handmaid is a servant to wash the feet of the servants of my Lord. And Abigail hurried and rose and mounted a donkey, and her 5 young women attended her. She followed the messengers of David and became his wife. David also took Ahinoam of Jezreel, and both of them became his wives. Saul had given Michal, his daughter, David's wife, to Palti, the son of Laish, who was of Galim. So that is the end of chapter 25. No. All right, so that is the end of chapter 25. So I'm going to give you a brief synopsis of what happened in the first book of Lord of the Rings. The first book is called Fellowship of the Ring, and Frodo just couldn't wait to go on the quest to destroy the Ring of Power. And he just jumped, and as soon as Gandalf said, hey, you need to go to Rivendell, he said, sure, Gandalf, I'll go. And they didn't see Gandalf on the way, but they were like, oh, that's cool. You know, and so there weren't, like, really that many dangers or anything. And then Gandalf, when they were in the middle of Moria, Gandalf just kind of fell in a hole, I think. And so he died, and that was really sad. And then they went and saw the elves. And Sam was really happy to see the elves, and that was awesome. Galadriel told them the future. Hey, everything's going to be hunky-dory. And, oh, by the way, there's this guy, Sauron, and he is going to enslave all of the races of...
Well, I thought he was nice.
Okay, I don't think I'm saying it quite right, but I think Kimberly's got it a little bit better, so... Why don't you listen to Kimberly? And here we are. Let me just show you the book first. The Two Towers by J.R.R. Tolkien. That is the next book that we're reading, The Two Towers. And coincidentally, this is the same picture. If you look at our poster that we have over there.
Sorry about the
light. You can't really see it.
You can't really see it, but maybe sometime we'll get a chance to see it. But right now, we're going to read the two towers. I'm going to take the dust jacket off so that we protect it, because dust jackets are very fragile and can rip really easily. I think Kimberly has been practicing, and she's going to read the synopsis to... excuse me, to you today, and hopefully it's a little bit better than what I just said, because I don't even know what I'm saying. Who was Tom Bombadil?
For real, Dad? Oh, wow, it even says synopsis. This is the second part of The Lord of the Rings. Sorry, I have sunburn, and my face is very pink today. That's not in the book, by the way. The first part, The Fellowship of the Ring, told how Gandalf the Grey discovered that the ring possessed by Frodo the Hobbit was in fact the One Ring, ruler of all the rings of power. It recounted the flight of Frodo and his companions from the quiet shire of their home, pursued by the terror of the Black Riders of Mordor. Until, at last, with the aid of Aragorn, I thought that would be spelled different, the Ranger of Erador, they came through the desperate perils to the House of Elrond in Rivendell. There was held a great council of Elrond, at which it was decided to attempt the destruction of the ring, and Frodo was appointed the Ring-Bearer. The companions of the ring were then chosen, who were to aid him in his quest, to come, if he could, to the Mountain of Fire in Mordor, the land of the enemy himself, where alone the ring could be unmade. In this fellowship were Aragorn and Boromir, the son of the Lord Gondor, representing men, Legolas, son of the Elven King of Mirkwood, for the elves, Gimli, son of Glowin, of the Lonely Mountain, for the dwarves, Frodo with his servant Samwise, and his two young kinsmen, Merodach and
Peregrine,
for the hobbits, and Gandalf the Grey. The companions journeyed in secret far from Rivendell in the north until, baffled in their attempt to cross the high pass of
Caradhras
in winter, they were led by Gandalf through the hidden gate and entered the vast mines of Moria, seeking a way beneath the mountains. There Gandalf, in battle with a dreadful spirit of the underworld, fell into the dark abyss, but Aragorn, now revealed as the hidden hire of the ancient kings of the West, led the company on from the east gate of Moria, through the elvish land of Lorien, and down the great river Arduin, until they came to the falls of Rarus. Already they had become aware that their journey was watched by spies, and the creature Gollum, who once possessed the ring and still lusted for it, was following their trail. It now became necessary for them to decide whether they should turn east to Mordor or go with Boromir and to the aid of Minas Tirith. I'm mispronouncing all these things. Minas Tirith, chief city of Gondor in the coming war, or should divide. When it became clear that the Ringbearer was resolved to continue his hopeless journey to the land of the enemy, Boromir attempted to seize the ring by force. The first part ended with the fall of Boromir to the lure of the ring, with the escape and disappearance of Frodo and his servant Samwise, and the scattering of the remainder of the fellowship by a sudden attack of orc soldiers, some in the service of the Dark Lord of Mordor. Some of the traitor Saruman of is Isengard, the quest of the Ring Bearer seemed already overtaken by disaster. The second part, The Two Towers, now tells how each of the members of the Fellowship of the Ring fared, until the coming of the Great Darkness and the outbreak of the War of the Ring, which is to be recounted in the third and last part. And I am going to give this to Dad, who is going to read chapter 1.
So, I have to say, The Two Towers is my favorite book. It might be my absolute favorite book outside of the 66 books in the Bible. I'm not actually sure of that, but it is definitely my favorite book of J.R.R. Tolkien, and obviously of The Lord of the Rings, and this is not staying very steady, so sorry about that. Alright, so I am now going to read chapter 1, which is called The Departure of Boromir. Of course, we know that Boromir has been talking about departing for some time. He's going off to Minas Tirith. So, we all know that's about to happen. I'm waiting for JJ to get back. Oh, is he over there? Okay. All right, so this is chapter 1, The Departure of Boromir. Aragorn sped up on the hill. Every now and again, he bent to the ground. Hobbits go light, and their footprints are not easy even for a ranger to read. But not far from the top of Spring crossed the path, and in the wet earth he saw what he was seeking. "I read the signs aright," he said to himself. Frodo ran to the hilltop. I wonder what he saw there. But he returned by the same way and went down the hill again. Aragorn hesitated. He desired to go to the high seat himself, hoping to see there something that would guide him in his perplexities. But time was pressing. Suddenly he leapt forward and ran to the summit, across the great flagstones and up the steps. Then, sitting on the high seat, he looked out. But the sun seemed darkened, and the world dim and remote. He returned from the north back again to north. He returned from the north back again to north and saw nothing save the distant hills. Unless it were that far away, he could see again a great bird like an eagle high in the air, descending slowly in wide circles down toward the earth. Even as he gazed, his quick ears caught sounds in the woodlands below, on the west side of the river. He stiffened. There were cries, and among them, to his horror, he could distinguish the harsh voices of orcs. Then suddenly, with his deep-throated call, a great horn blew, and the blasts of it smote the hills and echoed in the hollows, rising in a mighty shout above the roaring of the falls. "The horn of Boromir," he cried. "He is in need." He sprang down the steps and away, leaping down the path. "Alas, an ill fate is on me this day, and all that I do goes amiss. Where is Sam?" As he ran, the cries came louder, but fainter now, and desperately the horn was blowing. Fierce and shrill rose the yells of the orcs, and suddenly the horn calls ceased. Aragorn raced down the last slope, but before he could reach the hill's foot, the sounds died away, and as he turned to the left and ran toward them, they retreated until at last he could hear them no more. Drawing his bright sword and crying, "Elendil! Elendil!" he crashed through the trees. A mile, maybe, from Parth Ghalen, in a little glade not far from the lake, he found Boromir. He was sitting with his back to a great tree as if he was resting, but Aragorn saw that he was pierced with many black-feathered arrows. His sword was still in his hand, but it was broken near the hilt. His horn, cloven in two, was at his side. Many orcs lay slain, piled all about him and at his feet. Aragorn knelt beside him. Boromir opened his eyes and strove to speak. At last, slow words came. "I tried to take the ring from Frodo," he said. "I am sorry. I have paid." His glance strayed to his fallen enemies. 20 at least lay there. "They have gone, the halflings. The orcs have taken them. I think they are not dead. Orcs bound them. He paused, and his eyes closed wearily. After a moment, he spoke again. Farewell, Aragorn. Go to... That's not written, but maybe it's appropriate. Go to Minas Tirith and save my people. I have failed. No, said Aragorn. Aragorn, taking his hand and kissing his brow. You have conquered. Few have gained such a victory. Be at peace. Minas Tirith shall not fall. Boromir smiled. Which way did they go? Was Frodo there? Said Aragorn. But Boromir did not speak again. Alas, said Aragorn, thus passes the heir of Denethor, lord of the Tower of Gard. This is a bitter end. Now the company is all in ruin. It is I that have failed. Vain was Gandalf's trust in me. What shall I do now? Boromir has laid it on me to go to Minas Tirith, and my heart desires it, but where are the ring and the bearer? How shall I find them and save the quest from disaster? He knelt for a while, bent with weeping, still clasping Boromir's hand. So it was that Legolas and Gimli found him. They came from the western slopes of the hill, silently, creeping through the trees as if they were hunting. Gimli had his axe in his hand, and Legolas his long knife. All his arrows were spent. When they came into the glade, they halted in amazement, and then they stood a moment with heads bowed in grief, for it seemed to them plain what had happened. Alas, said Legolas, coming to Aragorn's side, we have hunted and slain many orcs in the woods, but we should have been of more use here. We came when we heard the horn, but too late, it seems. I fear you have taken deadly hurt. Boromir is dead, said Aragorn. I am unscathed, for I was not here with him. He fell defending the hobbits while I was away upon the hill. The hobbits, cried Gimli. Where are they, then? Where is Frodo? I do not know, answered Aragorn wearily. Before he died, Boromir told me that the orcs had bound them. He did not think that they were dead. I sent him to follow Merry and Pippin, but I did not ask him if Frodo or Sam were with him. Not until it was too late. All that I have done today has gone amiss. What is to be done now? First we must tend the fallen, said Legolas. We cannot leave him lying like carrion among these foul orcs. But we must be swift, said Gimli. He would not wish us to linger. We must follow the orcs if there is hope that any of our company are living prisoners. But we do not know whether the ring-bearer is with them or not, said Aragorn. Are we to abandon him? Must we not seek him first? An evil choice is now before us. Then let us do first what we must do, said Legolas. We have not the time or the tools to bury our comrade fitly, or to raise a mound over him. A cairn we might build. The labor would be hard and long. There are no stones that we could use nearer than the waterside, said Gimli. Then let us lay him in a boat with his weapons, and the weapons of the vanquished foes, said Aragorn. We will send him to the falls of Rauros and give him to Anduin. The river of Gondor will take care, at least, that no evil creature dishonors his bones. Quickly they searched the bodies of the orcs, gathering their swords and cloven helms and shields into a heap. See, said Aragorn, here we find tokens. He picked out from the pile of grim weapons two knives, leaf-bladed, damasked in gold and red, and searching further he found also the sheaths black, set with small red gems. No orc tools these, he said. They were borne by the hobbits. Doubtless the orcs despoiled them, but feared to keep the knives, knowing them for what they are, work of Westerness, wound about with spells for the bane of Mordor. Well now, if they still live, our friends are weaponless. I will take these things, hoping against hope, to give them back. And I, said Legolas, will take all the arrows that I can find, for my quiver is empty. He searched in the pile and on the ground about, and found not a few that were undamaged and longer in the shaft than such arrows as the orcs were accustomed to use. He looked at them closely, and Aragorn looked at the slain, and he said, "Here lie many that are now folk of Mordor. Some are from the north, from the Misty Mountains, if I know anything of orcs and their kinds. And here are others strange to me. Their gear is not after the manner of orcs at all." There were four goblin soldiers of greater stature, swart, slant-eyed, and with thick legs and large hands. They were armed with short, broad-bladed swords, not with the curved scimitars usual with orcs. And they had bows of yew in length and shape like the bows of men. Upon their shields they bore a strange device, a small white hand in the center of a black field. On the front of their iron helmets was set an S-rune wrought of some white metal. "I have not seen these tokens before," said Aragorn. "What do they mean?"
"S is for Sauron," said Gimli. "That is easy to read."
"Nay," said Legolas, "Sauron does not use the elf runes." "Neither does he use his right name, nor permit it to be spelt or spoken," said Aragorn. "And he does not use white. The orcs in the service of Barad-dûr use the sign of the red eye." He stood for a moment and thought. "S is for Saruman, I guess," he said at length. "There is evil afoot in Isengard, and the West is no longer safe. It is as Gandalf feared. By some means, the traitor Saruman has had news of our journey. It is likely, too, that he knows of Gandalf's fall. Pursuers from Moria may have escaped the vigilance of Lórien, or they may have avoided that land and come to Isengard by other paths. Orcs travel fast, but Saruman has many ways of learning news. Do you remember the birds?"
"Well, we have no time to ponder riddles," said Gimli. "Let us bear Boromir away."
"But after that, we must guess the riddles if we are to choose our course rightly," answered Aragorn.
"Maybe there is no right choice," said Gimli.
Taking his axe, the dwarf now cut several branches. These they lashed together with bowstrings and spread their cloaks upon the frame. Upon this rough bier, they carried the body of their companion to the shore, together with such trophies of his last battle as they chose to send forth with him. It was only a short way, yet they found it no easy task, for Boromir was a man both tall and strong. At the waterside, Aragorn remained watching the bier, while Legolas and Gimli hastened back on foot to Parth Galen. It was a mile or more, and it was some time before they came back, paddling two boats swiftly along the shore.
"There is a strange tale to tell," said Legolas. There are only two boats upon the bank. We could find no trace of the other."
"Have orcs been there?" asked Aragorn.
"We saw no signs of them," answered Gimli, "and orcs would have taken or destroyed all the boats and the baggage as well."
"I will look to the ground when we come there," said Aragorn. Now they laid Boromir in the middle of the boat that was to bear him away. The gray hood and elven cloak they folded and placed beneath his head. They combed his long, dark hair and arrayed it upon his shoulders. The golden belt of Lórien gleamed about his waist. His helm they set beside him, and across his lap they laid the cloven horn and the hilts and shards of his sword. Beneath his feet they put the swords of his enemies. Then, fastening the prow to the stern of the other boat, they drew him out into the water. They rowed sadly along the shore, and turning into the swift-running channel, they passed the green sward of Parth Galen. The steep sides of Tol Brandir were glowing. It was now mid-afternoon. As they went south, the fume of Rarus rose and shimmered before them, a haze of gold. The rush and thunder of the falls shook the windless air. Sorrowfully they cast loose the funeral boat where Boromir lay, restful, peaceful, gliding upon the bosom of the flowing water. The stream took him while they held their own boat back with the paddles. He floated by them, and slowly his boat departed, waning to a dark spot against the golden light. And then, suddenly, it vanished. Rorus roared on, unchanging. The river had taken Boromir, son of Denethor, and he was not seen again in Minas Tirith, standing as he used to stand upon the White Tower in the morning. But in Gondor, in after days, it long was said that the elven boat rode the falls and the foaming pool, and bore him down through Osgiliath, and past the many mouths of Anduin, and into the great sea at night under the stars. For a while the three companions remained silent, gazing after him. Then Aragorn spoke. "They will look for him from the White Tower," he said, "but he will not return from mountain or sea, or from sea." Then slowly he began to sing. Through Rohan, over fen and field, where the long grass grows, the west wind comes walking, and about the walls it goes. What news from the west, O wandering wind, do you bring to me tonight? Have you seen Boromir the Tall by moon or by starlight? I saw him ride over seven streams, over waters wide and gray. I saw him walk in empty lands until he passed away. Into the shadows of the north I saw him then no more. The north wind may have heard the horn of the son of Denethor. O Boromir, from the high walls westward I looked afar, but you came not from the empty lands where no men are. Then Legolas sang. From the mouths of the sea the south wind flies, from the sand hills and the stones, the wailing of the gulls it bears, and at the gate it moans. What news from the south, O sighing wind, do you bring to me at eve? Where now is Boromir the fair? He tarries, and I grieve. Ask not of me where he doth dwell, so many bones there lie, on the white shores and the dark shores under the stormy sky. So many have passed down Anduin to find the flowing sea. Ask of the north wind news of them the north wind sends to me. O Boromir, beyond the gate the seaward road runs south, but you came not with the wailing gulls from the grey sea's mouth. Then Aragorn sang again. From the gate of kings the north wind rides, and past the roaring falls, and clear and cold about the tower of its lord, of its loud horn calls. What news from the north, O mighty wind, do you bring to me today? What news of Boromir the bold, for he is long away? Beneath Amunhen I heard his cry, there many foes he fought. His cloven shield, his broken sword, they to the water brought. His head so proud, his face so fair, his limbs they laid to rest, and Rorus, golden Rorus, falls, bore him upon its breast. O Boromir, the Tower of Guard, shall ever northward gaze, to Rorus, golden Rorus, falls, until the end of days. So they ended. Then they turned their boat, and drove it with all the speed they could, against the stream, back to Parthgelen. "You left the east wind to me," said Gimli, "but I will say naught of it." "That is as it should be," said Aragorn. "In Minas Tirith they endure the east wind, but they do not ask it for tidings. But now Boromir has taken his road, and we must make haste to choose our own." He surveyed the green lawn quickly but thoroughly, stooping often to the earth. "No orcs have been on this ground," he said. "Otherwise, nothing can be made out for certain. All our footprints are here, crossing and recrossing. I cannot tell whether any of the hobbits have come back since the search for Frodo began." He returned to the bank, close to where the rill from the spring trickled out into the river. "There are some clear prints here," he said. "A hobbit waded out into the water and back, but I cannot say how long ago." "How then can you read this riddle?" asked Gimli. Aragorn did not answer at once, but went back to the camping place and looked at the baggage. "Two packs are missing," he said, "and one is certainly Sam's. It was rather large and heavy." "Then this is the answer.
Frodo has gone by boat, and his servant has gone with him. Frodo must have returned while we were all away. I met Sam going up the hill and told him to follow me, but plainly he did not do so. He guessed his master's mind and came back here before Frodo had gone. He did not find it easy to leave Sam behind. But why should he leave us behind and without a word, said Gimli. That was a strange deed. And a brave deed, said Aragorn. Sam was right, I think. Frodo did not wish to lead any friend to death with him in Mordor. But he knew that he must go himself. Something happened after he left us that overcame his fear and doubt. Maybe hunting orcs came on him and he fled, said Legolas. He fled, certainly, said Aragorn, but not, I think, from orcs. What he thought was the cause of Frodo's sudden resolve and flight, Aragorn did not say. The last words of Boromir he long kept secret. Well, so much at least is now clear, said Legolas. Frodo is no longer on this side of the river. Only he can have taken this boat, and Sam is with him. Only he would have taken his pack. Our choice, then, said Gimli, is either to take the remaining boat and follow Frodo, or else to follow the orcs on foot. There is little hope either way. We have already lost precious hours. Let me think, said Aragorn, and now may I make a right choice and change the evil fate of this unhappy day. He stood silent for a moment. I will follow the orcs, he said at last. I would have guided Frodo to Mordor and gone with him to the end. But if I seek him now in the wilderness, I must abandon the captives to torment and death. My heart speaks clearly at last. The fate of the bearer is in my hands no longer. The company has played its part, yet we that remain cannot forsake our companions while we have strength left. Come, we will go now. Leave all that can be spared behind. We will press on by day and dark. They drew up the last boat and carried it to the trees. They laid it beneath such of their goods as they did not need and could not carry. Then they left Parthgalen. The afternoon was fading as they came back to the glade where Boromir had fallen. There they picked up the trail of the orcs. It needed little skill to find. No other folk make such a trampling, said Legolas. It seems their delight to slash and beat down growing things that are not even in their way. But they go with great speed for all that, said Aragorn, and they do not tire, and later we may have to search for our path in hard, bare lands.
Well, after them, said Gimli. Dwarves, too, can go swiftly, and they do not tire sooner than orcs. But it will be a long chase. They have a long start.
Yes, said Aragorn. We shall all need the endurance of dwarves, but come. With hope or without hope, we will follow the trail of our enemies, and woe to them if we prove the swifter. We will make such a chase as shall be accounted a marvel among the three kindreds, elves, dwarves, and men. Forth the three hunters. Like a deer he sprang away. Through the trees he sped, on and on he led them, tireless and swift. Now that his mind was at last made up, the woods about the lake they left behind. Long slopes they climbed, dark, hard-edged against the sky, already red with sunset. Dusk came. They passed away, gray shadows in the stony land. That is the end of chapter one. The second chapter is called The Riders of Rohan, and the first word is dusk. And I hope that you're enjoying this story. And we will have to continue it tomorrow. So, God bless you. I think Kimberly's got a art gallery, so we will leave it off to her. And here she is.
Oh, sorry, you okay? Ta-da! Thank you for watching Heavy D Storytelling. I hope you all have a really good day, and God bless you.